Can I welcome everybody to the first meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2015. I'd like to wish everyone who follows the work of the Education and Culture Committee a Happy New Year, and remind all of those present that electronic devices should be switched off at all times because they do tend to interfere with the broadcasting system. Our first item is on the agenda this morning is it's a nice one in one way, in many ways, is to welcome Mark Griffin, and it would be to welcome Siobhan McMahon, although she's unfortunately delayed this morning and may not make it to the committee. But can I welcome Mark to the committee as one of our new Labour Party members? They obviously replaced Jane Baxter and Neil Bibby, who have now resigned from the committee, and I'm sure that all members would like to record their thanks to both Neil and Jane for the work that they undertook while they were members of the committee, but also to welcome Mark and Siobhan to the committee. So I'm sure we look forward to working with both Mark and Siobhan and wish Neil and Jane well in their new roles. However, can I begin by inviting Mark Griffin to declare any relevant registrable interests?
Okay, thanks for the welcome, Convener. I have no interests to declare relevant to the work of the committee.
Thank you very much. The second item on the agenda this morning is obviously that Neil Bibby's resignation means that we must also appoint a new Deputy Convener. The Parliament previously agreed that members of the Labour Party are eligible for this post. Can I invite nominations from members of that party for the Deputy Convenership?
If you're happy to nominate Siobhan McMahon.
I'm assuming that Siobhan will accept that nomination even though she's not here, so everybody content with that nomination?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. So I'm sure we'll pass on the good news to Siobhan that she's now the Deputy Convener of the Education and Culture Committee. Can I now turn to item 3 on our agenda, which is to discuss the success to date of Time to Shine, Scotland's first national youth art strategy. The 10-year strategy was published in November 2013, and we are fully aware that some of its aims may only be realised over the longer term. Nonetheless, today's session provides an opportunity to discuss a number of areas, and we are particularly interested in how the strategy has been implemented to date, how it's helped to change the provision of an engagement in youth arts, and of course the progress required to ensure its full implementation. Can I welcome to the committee this morning Judith Barclay, National Youth Orchestras of Scotland, Blair Boyle, Youth Arts Voice Scotland, Alison Hardie, Young Scot, Ken McGlashan, Youth Theatre Arts Scotland, and Mark Sheridan, Reader in Music and Creativity, the University of the Highlands and Islands. Can I welcome all of you to the committee this morning? We're going to get underway by going straight to questions from members. But before I ask members to come in, I just wondered whether, can I run along the line and just ask a very general background question. What do you believe the impact of Scotland's first youth strategy, art strategy, has been? Has it made a quantifiable difference to the way that youth arts are looked at and the way that they are actually dealt with on a day-to-day basis in Scotland? Can I begin with you, Mark, if you don't mind?
Yeah, I mean, I think the one key indicator about the Time to Shine and the investment is a recognition of the value of the arts and the young people in Scotland. And I think investing in confidence in the organisations across the country that work with young people. And I think that raising of confidence and a realisation, a recognition of the work is welcome, given the last few years of financial uncertainty and so on and so forth, and other priorities for our country to say we appreciate and we want to invest further in young people and culture is a big message for us, I think.
Okay, thank you. Judith.
I think I agree with everything that Mark said. Also, it's been a really fantastic opportunity for lots of arts companies and bodies to come together and collaborate as well, which I think has been a really, really positive thing that we can all kind of club together and try and make a difference. So I think that's been a massive positive from the strategy as well.
Okay, thank you. Ken?
I suppose just reiterating what's already been said, the feedback that we've had from our sector, Youth Theatre Arts Scotland work as a sector development organisation, so we represent a number of members and a number of different regions and practice as an umbrella organisation, and the feedback that we've had from our members and the participants at our events has been that it's been about those two things, recognition and dialogue. Firstly, it's about recognition about what they've already been doing and that the impact impact that they can have into the future. But also, I think that the dialogue that it's going to promote, both within the art form sectors, within the regions, but also beyond the art form sectors to the connected education and cultural sectors that they regularly engage with, is really exciting. It's really vibrant. It poses real opportunity for the future.
Thank you very much. Blair.
Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said as well. It's been great to sort of enrich young people's life with sort of the different sort of ideas of culture and arts. So far, it's been just the sort of early stages, but it's good to see how far it's going to go and how good it will be.
Okay, thank you. And Alison.
I think, you know, as Fiona Hislop wrote in the foreword to Time to Shine, she said if Scotland wants to become an international leader in youth arts, they must put young people at the heart of what we do. And I think that, you know, we're already starting to see that through the recruitment of Youth Arts Voice Scotland and the work that they're doing. And I think through that engagement with young people, what we'll start to see is improved targeted provision for young people across Scotland.
Okay, thank you. I think that's an interesting point, and it comes on to the next question that I wanted to ask before I bring in members, and that's really, again, a practical question. What has happened, what's been achieved because of the strategy that would not have been achieved? I know we're in early days, but what has been achieved by the strategy that would not have been achieved had the strategy not been in place? What changes have actually started to occur because of the strategy? You mentioned one there, Alison, I think, but... beyond that,
one of the things that I think kind of inspires me about the strategy and has was reassuring to our sector and our members was that it was the focus of the strategy. It seems to be upon the links and the connections and the networking, as opposed to maybe just upon funding buildings or specific practice in specific area. The Youth Theatre Arts Scotland were established 10 to 12 years ago out of a bit of research that was done by the Arts Council that recognised that there was a body that was needed within the youth theatre sector that sat distinct from those buildings and from those regions and from those individual companies that was going to professionalise the sector, was going to support the development of professionals within it, and was going to look at targeting gaps, barriers, opportunities for progression, participation. And also all the provision as well. So those three themes that have carried through into the strategy, we think is really exciting, because it's not about funding one specific company. It's about how the links are made that will then just raise the game sort of broadly across the nation. I think it was that kind of the character of the strategy that felt that was really encouraging, and we kind of feel like the legacy of the development that we've kind of shown in the youth theatre sector, that's become very proactive in its self-development, is I suppose evidence that model can work. It just needs to be given time. You know, we it took us a couple of years before we had that funding in place as an organisation, and it took a number of years before those different milestones were established. And so we think this strategy will just need the time to really create the long-term effects that Fiona Hislop has kind of outlined at the start of the okay. strategy.
Okay, thank you. Mark, yes.
Certainly for us in the Highlands, the establishment of the youth hubs has been a major advantage. Of course, around the country, and it has been a substantial investment. For the Highlands, we have 13 organisations of all sorts of different cultural and arts organisations, as well as community learning and the university. And it's brought organisations together who, despite inhabit the same environment, have little or had no involvement previously. And so that in itself is a major step forward. And of course, for those living in a rural community, any kind of integration or greater interface to enable us to get to, particularly harder to get young people, and those who live in isolated communities, the hub gives us an opportunity to think differently about how we do that, and to think innovatively and imaginatively across the arts and the way in which we work with young people. So it's early days, but that I think has been a really important step forward for us.
Thank you. I mean, no doubt we'll come on to the hubs. I'm sure members will have some questions on that. But in the meantime, can I call Colin Beattie?
Thank you, Mayor. With any sort of initiative like this, there's always a risk of creating another bureaucratic layer. Do you think we've avoided creating another bureaucratic layer? Or do you think that that is an issue?
I mean, I think from our point of view, I mean, Young Scots' role is to support young people's involvement and empower young people to participate in the strategy. So I think, you know, we need to work with the young people to make sure that you know, that there's not that other level of bureaucracy, and that young people are able to access and have influence over the strategy easily. And that's our role in terms of recruitment of the Youth Arts Voice Scotland group, and make sure that the young people are then empowered to go out and work with the hubs and the national organisations and so on, and make sure there's not that level of bureaucracy.
But have we actually avoided creating that bureaucratic layer?
I would say so, because I think that. I don't think there is really any evidence of it. I think because you've got the hubs distinct from the money that was just for the strategy itself, that very quickly the way that the objectives are being carried out has meant that the money is getting channeled directly to the networks on the ground. So actually the staffing of those hubs is very small. There's two or three people, and actually their job is links and connections, and so they're streamlining partnership working effectively in the region with some attention and investment towards that. The Youth Arts Programme Management Team is small as well within Creative Scotland, and even the events themselves are large networking events for national, local, regional organisations to kind of to come together. So I can't see the evidence of a large amount of administration or administration resource being used up by the funding that was set aside.
Just taking that step further, one of the key aims is to create access for all. It's to reach people or young people that otherwise we wouldn't have that opportunity to reach. Is there a danger that by widening that focus, that there could be a danger that Scottish artists might not achieve the sort of international excellence? In other words, that we're diluting the talent rather than bringing more up?
I would say no, it would be the opposite of that. If you're encouraging the sort of engagement, you're actually going to get more talent and more sort of engagement within the arts. It's not necessarily going to be diluted, it's going to be more concentrated, in fact.
Judith, did you want to? I just wanted to add as well, from being a national company, we are kind of quite different in some of the things that are going on. And I think it certainly doesn't dilute anything. We found at NIOS that it's giving us the opportunity to work with people that we wouldn't have necessarily worked with before, because I think everybody always looks at us as the kind of pinnacle. As a young musician, that's kind of what you aim towards. So I think we're not changing anything. We are opening up like at the grassroots level, so we've got all of our workshops and everything that we can offer young people, but there's still the scope there for the people that really want to reach the top of their game, that want to be kind of worldwide musicians that really want to go on and take it as a career. I think there's still the option to do that, so I definitely don't think we're diluting it in that sense.
I can understand a concern whenever an investment is made about the potential for centralisation of a bureaucracy, but I think our understanding of Creative Scotland and the way the facilitation, and I think Kenny's right about the way in which I would see it and the way we see it on the ground, is that there is a sense of ownership locally. I think when it comes to the dilution, I would say that it's the opposite. I think what Time to Shine does is build on what we do of Curriculum for Excellence and GIRFEC. It's about the individual young person in Scotland and about what they want to achieve and how we help them, no matter who they are. And I think there's a lot of young people who are not engaged with the arts and culture that could be. And I think the key to that, and I've mentioned it in my submission, is about not just interagency working in culture, but with community learning, with education, with the health and wellbeing agenda across local communities. So rather than diluting, I would like to see more people coming through to actually enrich what we have already. To give you a short anecdote, the chief executive of Scottish Opera, for instance, would comment that as a nation we have a small cohort potentially of being world-class opera singers. It's just a genetic fact about being a singer. You need large numbers of people for people to come through at particular ages. What we have is a nation of young people who can excel in all sorts of different areas, and I think being able to give people an opportunity to choose what they want to do and how to do it, I think we'll see more skilled and experts across a range of the arts and culture that we have in the country.
Ken.
Just wanted to add one thing. When again, as a sector development agency, Youth Theatre Arts Scotland, we characterise ourselves distinct from, for instance, the National Youth Theatre, Scottish Youth Theatre, or the National Youth Performing Arts companies, through, I suppose, the richness of diversity that we represent in terms of practice. And obviously, the National Youth Performing Arts Company, Scottish Youth Theatre, are really rich and diverse participants and projects as well. But for instance, our National Festival of Youth Theatre will see maybe 9 different youth theatres coming from 9 different regions within Scotland and beyond, all coming together to show different ways of working. So I suppose what I wanted to challenge is that this dissolution idea, for me, would come from there only being one track way to progress. And actually, I think Scotland is characterised by its diversity of practice, both within the regions but also within the art forms. And so what we find is really rich is at our National Festival of Youth Theatre is when these groups come together. One of the first National Festival of Youth Theatre I attended before I ran the organisation, the groups that I saw, one of them came from a youth theatre, a theatre that was a large building-based organisation. And then next to that, there was a young carers group. And it was just a youth theatre of 3 young people who wanted to come together and write their own stories. And then the next piece was an international project. And then the next piece was the Deaf Youth Theatre. And those are 4 companies who work in completely different ways and don't have 4 similar ways to progression. They've got 4 different ways to progression. So the dissolution idea doesn't really work because the pathways are so distinctly different.
Just a final question there. I was struck by a comment in the submission from Mark Sheridan, actually. It's page 2 of that submission, or page 3 on the pack. There's a comment made here from one of the practitioners, I think, that 2 years is a reasonable amount of time to set foundations, begin projects and raise awareness. But then it says 2 years is an overly ambitious target to develop fully sustainable arts provision. Maybe the panel could comment on that.
If I could pick up just initially, I think that what you'll see in a lot of the submission is this anxiety about sustainability. We have a 10-year vision. And 2-year funding, and there's always an anxiety in arts organisations of our exit strategy, and I think they're flagging up already. We see the potential for this, and we, as members of the hub, we've got to make it work. We've got to work together to try and engage and answer the question ourselves, as well as raising, I think, the potential for, as we come towards the middle of the second year or towards the end, okay, where are we going and how do we go there? I think that's really what's been raised there, but I'd be interested to hear commentary from others.
I think I would find that we find with a lot of the hubs that obviously the hubs are getting set up themselves. So we found that perhaps it's taken us longer to implement the workshops and all the work that we wanted to do. So I think our possible worry is that we're going to get to towards the end of the 2 years and we're only just going to be establishing those relationships. I think that the worry is, especially with being a national company, because we're not a self-sufficient hub, that we're supposed to be there to support others, that at the end of the 2 years that we might perhaps lose contact with them, that we're focusing everything into these 2 years, but it's difficult to get it all set up and to sustain it after the 2 years have passed.
Thank you very much.
Mary Scanlon.
Thank you. Well, I've been reading the same paper as Colin Beattie's been reading and the same community learning practitioner. Who also says we see limited evidence of organisations working together nearly a year into the project and hasn't really been discussed. She also, or he or she, we need to address how inclusion and equality are addressed, and at present there's limited evidence to show that this is at the forefront of arts organisations. As a MSP for the Highlands and Islands, I appreciate the difficulties in remote and rural areas, but my understanding is that this is what the strategy is all about, is, you know, to bring people forward to look at that talent, whether it's an opera singer from Betty Hill or from Unstore, whatever they want to do. And it seems that your own community learning practitioners aren't overly confident in the strategy.
I think this is an important statement from this practitioner. There have been a number of meetings of the hub. I mean, and to be honest, I mean, we haven't really got started until November. So it's a year on. It's not been a year on for the hubs because they were established in summer. But I think the point that she is raising is that, and from an educational perspective and working community arts as well as education, from my perspective, there's two different ways of looking at this. There's the arts and cultural organisations who do what they do really well and work with young people who tend to come to them anyway. What she's saying is we must be aware of the hard-to-get young people, the young people who have difficulty in engaging anyway. And she's initiating, or further initiating, conversations within the hub saying we must address this. And I'm with her, and the other organisations within the hub, we have discussed this, and it's part of our priorities to look at this.
To be a woman when she was speaking out so forcefully. Right, so yeah. we can be assured that inclusion and equality will be addressed in future.
Yeah,
can I just go on to my second point? Alison mentioned about international leader in youth arts. Well, the briefing paper that we've got from the Parliament's Research Office has shown that between 2008 and 2013, performing arts are, this is college students taking art courses. At school, there's not a huge change. But college students taking art courses, 2008 to 13, performing arts down 28%, dance down 83%, theatre and dramatic arts down 60%, music performance down 54%. It's not exactly going in the right direction to be an international leader in youth arts. What's happening?
Comment
here?
On that and open
very
it up.
Welcome.
Yeah. I think during the last decade,
this is just 8 to 13.
Yeah, but during the last decade, you know, previous to 2008, there was a large increase in number of arts courses in further education. Take my area of music, music production, music recording, music performance, music business, music commerce. There was large numbers. I think the reality of the world of creativity, the creative industries, is that there is probably fewer opportunities for young people to gain professional access. And we've recognised that over the years. And it's about recognising the courses that should be invested in, I think, at further education within the country. So although there's been fewer numbers, I think the courses that are now working, and we collaborate with lots of colleges across the UHI obviously, but also others in the Central Belt, you see very strong, powerful, well-motivated, well-skilled staff as well. I think we have strong numbers.
They're not powerful, but you know, these are the figures I've got here today.
Yeah.
And it doesn't make great reading.
I suppose
are these figures wrong?
I think what's probably missing is the numbers who would have graduated from those courses who then went on to work in the creative industries. That's the kind of measures that we probably don't have.
Well, there's an awful lot less graduating now than there were in 2008.
And it may be that there's more actually gaining employment now than there was previously. I think that may be the
issue.
Well,
it's a huge reduction, which is of serious concern. But can I just, my third question on creative and professional access, and Judith, I'll come to you in a second. But first of all, I have to say I was quite shocked to discover under the heading of crafts, if we look at creative arts, students enrolled in Scottish higher education institutions, out of 11,000 students in creative arts and design, in crafts we've got 60 in Edinburgh and 70 in Glasgow. we're not very serious about craft, creativity and crafts and professional access, and yet that is an enormous employability, money earner, whether you're sitting at home or, you know, craft and design is huge, and we can come up with 130. But given it's probably my last question, can I just ask if anyone wants to mention that? I mean, am I right to be shocked? Maybe not. Maybe that's the best we can do. But my final question is to you, Judith, and it's on music tuition fees. I did a Freedom of Information just before Christmas. I have to say I was quite shocked that in some areas you have to pay £30 a month for music tuition. In some areas you can do your SQA music exam free. Other areas you have to pay. Other areas you get concessions if you're on income support. Other local authorities you get nothing. Some are means tested. You get a little bit of help if you bring along all your earnings to the school and it's under 26,000. But the postcode lottery on music tuition has to bar an awful lot of talented people. And if we're serious about equality, giving everybody an equal opportunity, can I just ask for your thoughts on the charging of music tuition, and in your experience, has that stopped people from poorer backgrounds, or even people that are less than 26,000, mm-hmm. the humiliation and embarrassment of mm-hmm. taking payslips to the school to ask if they can get... Can I perhaps get a little bit of something on that? And convener, just something on the craft, please.
No, I completely...
No,
but the music tuition...
No, I'm not going to... I'm just going to say we'll need to try and
separate
it out.
That's my last question, just want an answer.
Well,
I can
answer
about music tuition.
Judith, if you start with the stuff on that.
Music tuition, I completely agree with. I think it's an absolute minefield of things. Yeah. I think that I agree. I think it can be embarrassing for young people to have to admit to any kind of financial problems.
That's right.
But I think, you know, it's such a massive issue. Because, I mean, we're still suffering cuts all over the place with, you know, kind of Saturday morning music centres. So I think that we're in a position whereby people have got to be charged for it because there's a lack of resources and everything. So I think that we do, I mean, it is a massive thing. We need to look at how we can iron it out and so we can have equality for everybody. I think, you know, it is that we're suffering a lot of cuts, and then if, you know, kind of young people are suffering from these cuts, then they're having to pay, like, private tuition because there is no... there's nothing there for them to use. So it's then looking at kind of private tuition, which of course is going to be expensive. So I think it is an issue, but I mean, I just don't know how we would address that because it's completely off balance everywhere you look, and there's just so many problems with cuts.
But it's a priority, that's what it's about.
Well, I would say it was a priority, but that's from being a musician, and I think that could be a whole other thing of how the arts and everything can have such a massive positive impact on young people's lives. And I would like to think that this will, I think it will take time. Going back to your point as well about the numbers drastically dropping, I think that with any kind of art, it takes a long time to perfect that, to be at the standard where you're going to be going to a conservatoire or you're going to go and study. So I think that's worth taking into consideration, that the initial impact of this isn't going to show straight away in figures like that. It's going to be in 7-8 years' time when kind of young people have managed to perfect their skills and they're at a higher level. So I think those figures aren't necessarily fair on kind of what's going on.
They're not going to perfect their skills if they can't afford it.
No, but there are ways of doing it. I mean, certainly as a national company we do, we've got a bursary scheme, so we will never turn away anybody. There's lots of avenue there for people, and with things like regional residencies and the work that's going on with Time to Shine, it's giving people like us a chance to go into, say, perhaps young people that can't afford to go and do music courses, but they're getting something for free that will help them get better at their art, will perfect it, and we're managing to do that without them having to spend any money.
Thank you. I'm just going to bring in Mark first, if you don't mind. Also, Mark.
Okay. Just very briefly, on the music tuition, when I first entered music education in 1979 and then into the 80s, introduction of standard grade and so on, As it was then, Scottish Examination Board exams, there was about 2,800 students, and I can send you papers on this, studying O grade and higher. Now we have 30,000 young people studying across SQA courses in schools. I think that speaks for itself. In terms of craft, I don't have the information you have there, but I know in our own institution, Shetland and Orkney, for instance, just two, I can send you again the figures on this, in terms of craft development in jewellery and wool, for instance, in small business and the creative industries, these are very important sectors for Orkney and Shetland. And again, I can send information about this from our department, just to maybe, enlighten some of the debate. But that's all I want to say.
The figures that we have that Mary Scanlon was referring to are only craft at higher education institutions. So that's obviously not the full picture. So that'd be very helpful. Sorry, Ken.
I just wanted to make two quick points, really. One of which was about just from my own kind of experience of working across different formal education settings, is the awareness of how the investment is massively different for different art form, and it's obvious when you think about it. You know, if I do a class of 30 youth theatre young people, I need one tutor and one room. But if I do a musician teaching tuition piano lesson, I need one tutor and one room to one person. So if I want to train 30 young people, it costs 30 times the amount. And so it starts to be, breaking it down into what the specific economies of each art form and also each region and each age, actually, it starts to show how the investment begins to feel quite thin on the ground when you're talking about a long-term kind of development. The other point I just wanted to talk to is obviously we haven't had the figures that you're talking to about the higher education statistics, but I think with the youth art strategy, with Time to Shine, I suppose that dialogue, I suppose it feels a wee bit more, that recognition and that dialogue that we talked about at the start in our kind of opening responses, the youth arts industries are now at the table having those discussions as opposed to just feeding people from a voluntary basis, from a strategic interest, that actually, you know, we're on a stronger footing with the Time to Shine strategy to connect with the social work departments, with higher education, with formal education, to make those links and those pathways happen. I think that it will be about returning to those statistics in the years to come to see the impact that's been made.
Okay. Yes.
Obviously, I'm not sure of statistics either, but one of the biggest things that I've learned, because obviously I'm going through my university application just now to art school, there's not as much places as there is to those people who apply. So for 60 or 70 people, there may be 200, 300 applicants. I don't know if that's there or not.
No, it's not.
No. So, for example, when I've been told the Glasgow School of Art, they have 300 places per year on a generalised sense, but they have 4,000 applicants. That's just like a sort of generalised term. I think it would be similar for Edinburgh College of Art and other higher education institutions as well. It's very competitive. So it might be the idea of sort of either raising how many the intake of the higher education facilities, but at the same time, maybe what you were talking about earlier, diluting the talent that might do that, but at the same time, that might sort of encourage the talent progression as well.
Okay, thank you. Gordon, you're a supplementary, you wanted to ask, I think.
Well, it was just on the whole point of the figures that Mary raised, it was the numbers we've got were obviously all produced prior to the Time to Shine strategy coming in. And of course, we've had the refocus on colleges to more full-time equivalent courses. So when you actually look at the full-time equivalent, the numbers aren't as dramatic as Mary has pointed them out to be. But my other concern is we don't seem to have a lot of evidence about the higher education institutions, about how they're progressing in terms of numbers that are taking up courses with higher education, and I'm just wondering if you have any information on that and any view on whether there are more availability in higher education institutions than colleges.
want to know is then about this. In our sector, obviously, in universities, we are governed by the numbers from Scottish Funding Council. My understanding is in the last few years, the only institution that has been able to expand numbers has been the University of the Highlands and Islands in the last couple of years at undergraduate level because of our new status as a fully funded university. But across certainly music and arts, the numbers have been similar over the last few years, Glasgow, Edinburgh, Aberdeen, in terms of music intake. UHI, we've managed to expand in applied music and in some of our other courses, and that will continue for another year. We seem to be steady state in terms of visual arts and digital and drama and theatre and so on. And we were talking about hundreds across the sector in Scotland, and I think it's fairly healthy. I think we've got a pretty strong arts and culture cohort in the universities. I'm confident that we have the right kind of numbers and it is competitive, but then again, you know, there's a great investment in STEM subjects. And while we like to lobby for our world, we also have to recognise the demands of other areas of our industry and business and our economy. Yeah.
I'm going to ask a supplementary myself on that, because I know Mary read out the figures, which were the per head figures, the head count. But I think Gordon's quite right. And I'd like to know your opinion about this shift in emphasis between part-time courses, short courses and full-time courses, because in terms of full-time equivalence between 2008-09 and 2012-13, performing arts, far from going down, in terms of full-time equivalent, has gone up. Theatre and dramatic arts up, music history and theory up, theatre production up. So there's been a shift, although the headcount may have decreased, the actual number of hours is actually increased. So I just wondered whether or not, what your views were about that shift in policy between funding a lot of short courses or part-time courses to more full-time courses. Kenny?
Speaking from, I suppose, a distant perspective of awareness of the pathways that young people would take following their youth theatre experience, considering going on to further education, higher education and then into the industry. In years gone by, I'm not saying this with any kind of great kind of detailed authority, but with years gone by, some of the character of the discussion used to be that there was a lot of one-year HNC courses which weren't of a high standard. I would be working with young people on a summer project and they'd be coming to me for full time for 5 weeks working on a production, a youth theatre production, and they would go away having had a life-changing experience, and they would go into a further education course, and I would meet them a little bit down the line and they would be talking about the fact that they were maybe in 2 days a week on that course and they weren't getting the same quality of experience because they weren't doing it for that full-time intense experience. And so I agree. I think that some of the part-time courses have streamlined throughout, and I would imagine that that's going to happen further with the changes to the further education, with the consolidation of the further education sector. And I think that can only really be welcomed. My sense is that the further education colleges in theatre that are out there have been streamlined, and it's now kind of it's kind of plateauing to the right kind of sense. And also there's a clear pathway onto other higher education courses and degrees, but also I think that, you know, it's clear that there's more apprenticeships and graduate schemes and other models as well, that that it's not just that single pathway that we need to capture the figures of in the future.
Okay, Mark, did you want to come in?
Sorry, can I just say that, you know, I've looked at a spice briefing from this Parliament staff. The source is the Scottish Funding Council. I have read it as it's been given. There are no footnotes to say we're not comparing apples with apples, etc. We've now had various people interpreting the statistics. So can I maybe ask that we get accurate information about the number of college students taking art courses before we do come to any conclusion here? Because, you know, if we as a committee have not been given accurate, if we're looking at part-time courses, in 2008 and now looking at full-time courses in 2013, then I want to know if
I don't think that's what's happening.
Inaccurate information.
No, it's not inaccurate at all. What we're looking at is just give us 1 second. We're looking at two tables. The first table is a head count. It says count. You can see that on the table 3. And in table 4, it's the full-time equivalent. So while the head count, as I was asking the question to Kenny McGlashan, has dropped, you were quite right in terms of reading out the accurate figures in terms of the head count.
So my figures are accurate.
In terms of
on
head
count. Page 9, it's another table, but table 3
Mary, just one
is
second.
Accurate.
One second. And I didn't say it was. What I said was the head count, you're quite right to have said that the head count has dropped, but the full-time equivalent figure has gone up. That's why I asked about the policy shift.
It hasn't gone up. It's gone down for dance. It's gone down for music history and theory, down for music performance, and down for music instrument technology.
Not by the percentages that
it's
you suggested.
It's gone up for theatre and music history.
I specifically read out the figures that have gone up. So the figures that you said were headcount drops, they haven't dropped by the percentages that you said in terms of the full-time equivalent, which was the questions that I was asking. But I wish Mr. Sheridan now to answer the question that I was asking. Mr. Sheridan.
There's obviously issues about supply and demand as well in terms of some areas of the arts and culture and how things change. But there has been in the last 5 years, maybe more, a structural change at all universities. Every time we have a new course now and through senates and court, we have modular courses and we have exit and entrance strategies for year one or year two and year three. So students, there's no such thing as a conventional student now. We need to cope for lots of young people coming from school, but also people of all sorts of ages and from different backgrounds. So what you have now is a suite or a building blocks for people to take advantage of doing individual modules or a number of modules or being able to do part-time first year of university over 2 years and then exit and come back in and so on. So I think the FTE we live with, we are used to people coming in and going out of courses at different levels and so on. And it also helps articulation from HNC and HND. So that has been a big shift in the last 7 or 8 years. And I think that can account for some of the policy changes that you're seeing in the numbers.
Okay, thank you very much. Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much. I'm going to start by apologising for my late arrival. It was due to flight delays. And I think, as I said during the debate on this, very much welcome the Time to Shine strategy, and it's encouraging to hear the positive messages. I think I was struck a bit by the point that came through, Mark, in your submission about the sustainability and the risk, I suppose, with 2 yearly reviews, that as in other areas, we're tempted to dig up the roots to see if the plant is growing fine, to little effect and possibly potential damage to the structure we put in place. I mean, are you confident that the way the review structure has been set up, that there are benchmarks along the way, and that what we won't end up doing is affecting kind of handbrake turns every 2 years to try and deal with specific issues that may arise?
I think if anything, we need to flag up to the hubs and to other organisations about integration, about working closely together and really doing that and seeing that as a long term, like other organisations are doing across the country since the Christie Commission, thinking differently about how we use resources. To give you an example, I'm the vice chair of Face Ross, which is one of the hub organisations that really led on in the management for our Highland Youth Arts Hub. I think what we'd be looking to do is ensure that the manager that we appointed through the Highland Youth Arts Hub, that the organisations, as we move into the last of the second years, that we try and retain the manager. In other words, that from our own resources and our own investments, that we will actually maintain that. And I think the integration of organisations, the like-mindedness, the idea of working together is really what we have to develop on the ground to ensure that any further investment that will naturally come to organisations will in fact support the ongoing integration and articulation and collaboration, if that makes sense.
That's helpful. I mean, again, something I think, Kenny, you mentioned the fact that what this was about was as much developing and enriching networks and connections and developing sort of creative ways of bringing together work that's probably already happening or opening up opportunities to those that at the moment don't have those. Looking at the hub structure, and I don't want to be overly hung up about that, but you'll forgive me if I think that perhaps the islands are conspicuous by their absence from that hub structure. One or two others, I mean the Borders, Dumfries and Galloway again are notable in not being included in that. I did raise it with Fiona Hislop during the debate about how in a sense you build those networks and develop that sort of young person input in those areas where there isn't a hub. I'm not sure I got an answer during the debate. I wondered whether those at the coalface might have a view as to how you kind of reach beyond the specific regions where the hubs are based.
I think it was, this is speaking to a person from my personal opinion, I think it was a little unhelpful that the hubs and the strategy kind of came out at the same time, because I think actually the hubs are a mechanism to progress a lot of the objectives, but it's not the strategy. And I think actually that from our I think we understand, Youth Theatre Arts Scotland understand that implicitly because we're a sector development organisation. But, you know, the Youth Arts Strategy and Creative Scotland have been at pains to emphasise this, is that it's not just the hub's strategy, it's not just their activity, it is the National Youth Performing Arts Companies, but likewise it's also youth work organisations as well and social development organisations as well. So I think that's quite an important thing to say initially, because the next thing is very much that I'm sure that Creative Scotland and all those regions would have wanted a hub in every region, and actually I think everybody would kind of support that, but there's a tipping point in terms of actually if you spread it so thin, are you going to get the infrastructure development that you want? And so I think that the level of investment in those the regions that have been selected is the right level for the moment. I know that there's a smaller investment in, I think, two other areas from ideas that were submitted, but they aren't going to be full hubs. And I was reminded about it in the submission from Creative Scotland. But yeah, I mean, I would certainly hope that if ongoing investment is secured, that other regions would get a similar investment, and that in the interim, that actually the attention is put, as I understand it, is being done through the National Youth Performing Arts Companies to support work in the regions that didn't get the hub investment in particular.
I mean, I suppose to some extent, I think Mark alluded to it earlier, I mean, the area I represent in Orkney is a very vibrant arts and cultural scene, music scene, and into which young people play an absolutely integral part. It's understanding better how that links with kind of regional and national organisations that is an issue, and while those that are excluded can be excluded for many reasons, social reasons, economic reasons, but also issues of rurality. And I think it would be helpful to understand whether as part of this strategy there's a recognition that there are many with a wide variety of talents but who find themselves very, very distant from where it is appropriate or sensible or reasonable to try and coalesce and deliver courses or whatever, and therefore support for travel, for accommodation, even for those who aren't necessarily at the sort of poorest end of the spectrum but for whom this is prohibitively expensive to go away for multiple weeks or a year's duration course. Is that something that's picked up in the strategy?
If I could take that one, sorry. We found that with us, we've got a kind of collection of workshops that we've done, and one of the things that we're offering is something called Route NIOS, which is focusing on not only going out to hubs, but also places that haven't been picked up and aren't a hub, and going out and basically offering support to them. So we're definitely, as a national company, we're trying to pick into places that don't have any provisions at the moment, and we're trying our hardest to really target those areas as well. Mm-hmm. I think something that hasn't really been picked up on is about the digital platform as well. I think there's been a fantastic kind of recognition of how powerful digital and social media and kind of things can be. And I think that's something that we're definitely working on. I think a lot of the hubs are as well, is kind of having that quite powerful digital presence as well, which is something that the young people use and something that anybody can access. So in that way that they're still being able to tap into what's going on as well, even if it is just digitally.
part of the role of the Young People's Group, Youth Arts Voice Scotland, is to evaluate, you know, what's happening locally in terms of Time to Shine. And that's not just in the hub areas, but in areas where there isn't representation through the hub as well. So we're very conscious of the young people as a group that we need to build those links within the areas that don't have a regional hub, and make sure that the young people are working locally to raise awareness of work that's going on in those areas. And also, I mean, one of the things that the group are looking at is a young ambassador scheme, so recruiting young people to act as ambassadors for the arts in every region across Scotland. So part of their work will be to look at areas where there isn't representation of hubs. And the last residential meeting that we had, we did a bit of an equalities impact assessment around the group, and that also then included geography, and rurality came up as an issue around there in terms of representation on the group. So what we're looking to do is then expand group membership to make sure we have that representation across the country.
Did you have something you wanted to add?
Can I just pick up on the digital and the sort of idea of our last residential? The digital platform, it goes live this week, as far as I'm aware, and that's going to be a real sort of way to sort of reach out to the areas that don't have hubs. It's going to inform them of things that are on in their areas as well, due to the sort of cooperation between the arts organisations all over Scotland. It's going to have a calendar too, where you can see everything that's on in your ear regarding youth arts, things like that. And like Alison was saying about the sort of last residential we attended, we did meet with Evaluation Support Scotland to think of ways that we can evaluate the strategy as it goes on without making it to seem too sort of distant from the young people. So we were looking at ways of getting triggers and outcomes, and it went quite well the first time.
Thank you. Ken?
I just wanted to say that one of the things that we found as a sector development organisation is that by having ongoing support and strategy, we've been able to put in regular events and projects that I think is quite relevant to your question about involvement from different regions at whatever stage that they're at and whatever level of investment that they've gone. So the National Festival of Youth Theatre that I've mentioned before has been running for 10 years now. In some cases we've seen youth theatres return year upon year, and each year grow their own ambitions about what they do when they come to us. Similarly, it's allowed regions who are there's a kind of seed investment that's gone in and has helped them develop. It's given them a place to go to, and firstly they aspire to what they see, and then they come and they develop their own provision. Or there's a way for them to find out about our network organisation and how they can learn from other practitioners. So I think that that's where some of the nervousness about the long-term investment kind of comes from our sector, is that we want to set up the infrastructure so that it's not just about who's doing it right now, but people 3 or 4 years down the line who just discover that opportunity by themselves and then can find their own way in, that they can start to make that connection for developing their practice.
Okay, thank you. I mean, that's an interesting point about the sustainability of the strategy. I mean, we talked briefly earlier about the establishment of the 2-year figure that came up. Can I ask you generally, I mean, you know, will the structures be in place sufficiently robust by the end of that period to hopefully generate and create sustainability over the next few years? Because clearly this is a 10-year strategy, and 2 years isn't sufficient to implement a 10-year strategy. Kenny?
I think because we've funded the links in the first instance, mm-hmm. I think that for me is about setting up the infrastructure so that then any further investment will continue to bleed straight through, ripple out into the delivery. So I think that it is. I think that it's folly to think that you're going to get the start, middle and end of the ambitions of the Time to Shine strategy in the 2 years. Instead, what I think you'll start to see is you'll start to see at the end of the 2 years at the I think what you'll start to see is the impact that it could make, and also a streamlining of the ideas that can happen in each region, and I suppose a celebration of the diversity of what's happening. I think the hubs, as an example, are all set up in a slightly different way, and I think what will happen at the end of the 2 years is that they'll all have created their own identity, they'll have created their own network and infrastructure, and we'll be seeing a different way of communicating and networking across art form. I think that's one of the things that I found really exciting throughout this, is that we've got a network organisation in our youth theatre art form, but that doesn't exist in film, and it doesn't exist in multiple other areas, craft and for youth, for young people that we've kind of talked about. But actually, we've kind of gone a stage beyond that with the hubs and with the youth art strategy, that there's a network of networks now, effectively. And I think that at the end of those 2 years, it will be ready to make that impact rather than having achieved that impact yet. But it's the infrastructure that you've alluded to.
Okay, thank you. Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Queenie. Spoken earlier in earlier answers to questions about the increasing number of people who are now participating in arts, and I just wanted to ask a question around that and the balance, where the balance lies in the strategy and developing audiences and appreciation of the arts, as opposed to increasing the number of people who are participating, just to see if there's any views on whether that balance is right, because obviously without and the audience, then you don't really have the art.
Who wants to give a view on that? Blair.
I think one of the things that the arts in general do is sort of challenge your views of things, and it's good to sort of challenge young people's views of arts, and the strategy does aim to do that by increasing the participation, but other ways it would aim to do that is by getting peer engagement. Like, someone might not want to do the arts, but their friend does it, and that would be the audience sort of idea, and obviously all their families would be interested, all that sort of ideas, because it is young people you're engaging and dealing with, so it's very much based on them and their network, who they're engaged with.
Yes, Mark?
I think, in answer to the previous question and also to yours, Mr. Griffin, that if organisations like all of ours engage with young people and we embody the philosophy of Time to Shine, engagement, participation and so on within our organisations, then I think it will continue as embedded also in our education system and the way that we see the world. I think you're absolutely right. If more people are engaged with the arts, then there will be more of an audience. They will ask hard questions. They will want to develop their own view of the world. They will want to attend galleries. They will want to see the world differently. So if you're engaged locally in these sort of activities, you're going to want to go to theatre. You're going to want to go to music concerts. You're going to want to go to galleries. You're going to be encouraged to do that because you've been exposed to it. And I think that our national companies and local companies and other organisations who are not directly involved in the hubs, for instance, the Sheridan Arts Trust, they have the same philosophy, the same way of working, and they will encourage people to engage as audience participants. And the further you can get into rural communities and other communities who don't normally engage in the arts and culture, then the greater the audience participation in the long run, I think.
The youth ambassadors and the champions projects within Time to Shine, you know, is to try and increase that awareness, not just around participation, but around going and attending arts performances and so on as well. So having young people, as Blair said, to do that peer-led work within their local communities and raise that awareness, I'm sure will support some of that.
I also think that, just going back to my earlier point about the fact that the strategy isn't just for youth arts deliverers, that it's also for education providers and professional arts organisations as well. I think that I mentioned in our submission that we're part of a group called Culture Counts, who is a research and advocacy group of cross art form cultural organisations championing the role of culture across society. And specifically within Scotland, and what I find that's interesting through that is that I think with the Time to Shine strategy, it's I suppose you know, sent something really up important up the flagpole that says to people, this is your future audiences. And, you know, often I think that, you know, with kind of tight budgets or arts organisations can be looking at the here and now and maybe aren't really that worried about 5-10 years down the line. But actually the Time to Shine strategy, I think, has raised the level of importance of youth arts and the recognition, so that that flow through of an audience from participation into being an audience member is just the natural one that really exists out there. I think the other thing I would say is that young people quite often enjoy engaging through participating, and I think that they don't see it as distinct. This is a very broad statement, but they don't see it as distinct as we might do when we're becoming old and decrepit. They don't see it quite as distinct as that. They do, they watch, they chat, they just do it all. It's all one spectrum of participation and engagement. There's not the same distinct things that, you know, we perceive when we're more embarrassed about treading the boards and we want to just go and watch it. I think that's a different perception, I think, I've witnessed in young people.
Okay, thank you. There are, you know, if I'm right, about 24, maybe 23, I think, might be objectives across the three areas of a participation, progression, and provision in the strategy. How far are we down the road in meeting these objectives? I mean, are we got one or two already ticked off, or are we halfway there? Or given it's a long-term strategy, could you give us some idea about these objectives and how many of them have already been met or are on the way to being met at the moment? They're under construction, if I can put it that way. Who wants to? Because there are objectives in each of these categories.
I would just say that there's a few on there, you know, talking about being an international leader and talking about you know, connecting, you know, with the education frameworks and that there's a few in there which are clear long-term objectives and actually it's great that they're in there because I think it keeps us all focused on the kind of the ambitions and the opportunity that's there. But I mean, I think it would really just be early signs that we would be looking for.
Can I ask you about some of the specifics then? I mean, the very first one in objective in participation is to establish a national young people's advisory group to advise on the implementation and development of forward plans of Time to Shine.
That's a tick.
Done. Right. So some of them have been done.
Yep.
But, you know, but some of them, I agree with you, are more distant. But some of the other ones I'm wondering about are things like develop work and increase access to opportunities for the youngest age group and ensure the arts are effectively represented in the national early years strategy development across all sectors. Blair?
I think I'm not 100% sure of this, but I read something the other day that Creative Scotland's doing. Is it Starcatchers? Mm-hmm. It's engaging with early years. It's quite young. I think it's possibly 0-4, but I'm not 100% sure. And it's definitely aimed towards getting engagement of very young people, like obviously toddlers, engaged in the arts, so that's pretty much going ahead.
Okay. So Mark?
The Time to Shine isn't in isolation. There's a lot of fantastic work in the arts and creativity in the early years education anyway, and I think what it does is flag up we need to think across the sector and joined up and gather all the good practice and ensure good practice, participation and progression. Progression, if we can all buy into progression, the idea that we move on and that young people develop skills and knowledge and understanding and don't just keep doing the same thing over and over again, and what they want to do, for instance, is embedded, then I think these are objectives that we can meet. And I think that you're right, there are a number that we can already say, you know, being proactive and using digital technology, we're advancing that, we're moving into it. In our area, it's very difficult because we have thin band rather than broadband, and even that's patchy at times. But we're all aware of these objectives, and I think to have them, you know, as a teacher at one time, there's nothing wrong with too many objectives. You know, there's things to do. You know, that's your homework for next week. But being realistic as we review in the next couple of years, I think it's going to be important in what has been achieved. But yeah, it's still early days for the hubs, but we're aware of these issues, and at least we have them all in black and white and up front to tackle them and to tackle them together, I think.
I think
One of the roles, again, of Youth Arts Voice Scotland is to look at these objectives and look at how they're going to be measured and evaluated. And what the group are doing at the moment is working with Evaluation Support Scotland to work out how that is going to happen and also develop a logic model so that we can then easily demonstrate how some of the objectives are being met.
Well, that's interesting, because my next question, a follow-up question, was whether the timescales have now been established in order to effectively determine whether there are, we're going to achieve all the objectives and whether it's clear who should actually deliver them. Are you saying that that is actually now happening?
Certainly the group are putting together measurable outcomes that as a group they will work with in their local communities, making links with the hubs to make sure that the hubs are then delivering what they're supposed to be doing locally. But in terms of a timescale, I don't think.
I'm trying to see a little bit of clarity whether the timescales have actually been set down, whether they've been established, or whether is that still a work in progress.
Work in progress.
Journey.
Well, other things are journey, but sometimes there are
I think
stops along
Scotland
the way.
Certainly laid out evaluation, engaging with all of the participants on effective evaluation and tools for evaluation and how to progress that. These measures, one like, for instance, continually strive for quality improvement, that is a lifelong ambition for everybody. And the more young people you take on board into the stream, then you start the whole process again. I think most of us are fairly confident that the organisations we work with can address these and go a long way to meet them within the timescale, or at least know where we're going once the 2 years has elapsed.
Thank you very much. Any other members, any questions at this point? Okay, can I thank you very much for your attendance today? It's been very helpful. I know that there's one or two bits of information, I think, Martin, you said you were going to send to the committee, so we'd be grateful if we received that. And I think it's just worth mentioning that the committee will be hearing from Creative Scotland at a future date, so we'll also raise some of the issues that you've raised today, both in your written submissions and in your oral evidence today, and I'm sure other things as we progress between now and the date at which Creative Scotland come before the committee. So again, can I thank you very much for attending this morning, and can I briefly suspend the meeting? Before we move on to our next item of business, because I just say to the committee that Chick Brody has given his apologies today. He's unable to be here due to ill health. But can I welcome James Dornan to the committee for the first time? So, given this is your first time at the committee, James, can I ask if you have any relevant registrable interests that you wish to declare?
Nothing outside of my register of interests.
Okay. Thank you very much. Our next item is to take evidence on two affirmative instruments as listed in our agenda. Can I welcome to the committee for the first time Fiona McLeod, who is the Acting Minister for Children and Young People, and can I also welcome her supporting officials. After we have taken evidence on the instruments, we will debate the motions in the name of the Minister. Officials are not permitted to contribute to that formal debate. So therefore, can I invite the Minister to make some general opening remarks? Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for welcoming me to the committee. I look forward to working with you over the next 6 months while I'm the Acting Minister. Just a few comments in opening for these two instruments. In the main, these two instruments give effect in secondary legislation to procedural refinements to the Children's Hearing System introduced by the Children and Young People Act 2014. The primary legislative changes were proposed following the implementation of the Children's Hearing Act 2011 back in June 2013. As you would expect, we monitor the Act once in operation to make any refinements necessary. The Children's Hearing provisions in the 2014 Act were considered by this committee when that Act was at stage two of its parliamentary passage, and it was considered by the committee on the 21st of January last year. In the main, those provisions amend the Children's Hearing Act 2011 and are to be commenced on the 25th of January. The detail for operating children's hearings and related proceedings under the 2011 Act is contained in the Children's Hearings Act 2011 Rules of Procedures in Children's Hearings Rules 2013, in shorthand, the 2013 Rules. These instruments before you today are mainly about giving effect to consequential changes to these 2013 rules and related secondary legislation. However, we're also taking the opportunity in Rule 7 to address an issue concerning the non-disclosure of information contained in reports prepared by a children's hearing for a court under Section 95(2) of the Adoption and Children Scotland Act 2007. And I'd be happy to take any questions on the draft instruments.
Okay, thank you very much. Before moving to questions from members, I have a question myself. I noted when I was reading the papers for this meeting that the children's hearing instrument notes the consultation that has been undertaken, but on the other instrument it says that no consultation was undertaken. And I was wondering whether, in the first one, where you undertook a consultation, were there any issues that were raised and what were they? And secondly, on the one on secure accommodation, why no consultation was undertaken?
Can I, at this point, Convener, turn to my officials, because it's not something I'm completely up to date with yet.
Okay.
So on the consultation, on the two consultations.
Yeah, I think on the secure instrument, we felt that was such a minor and technical change that we felt that consultation wasn't really required, because it was really to implement a provision which was contained in the 2014 Act.
How normal is it that you don't undertake consultations on these changes, these sort of changes?
My experience, if it's of a technical nature, my experience is we haven't undertaken a consultation at all.
Well, can I be clear then, Ministers? What is exactly the secure accommodation one does? Just so we're clear about, you know, how technical in nature it was.
The purpose of the amendment to this regulation is as a result of ICSOs, which is the Interim Compulsory Supervision Orders, and they're made under Section 95, where there's an urgent necessity. So this amendment to this regulation was needed to reflect a change in the 2013 secure regulations, which, if I remember, had already been consulted on.
So the original regulations were consulted on. Right. Okay, thank you for that. And in terms of the children's hearing one, where there was a consultation that was undertaken, what issues were raised from that consultation?
there were no major issues that were raised at all. The proposals in the 2014 Act were the subject of consultation with relevant stakeholders like SCRA, Children's here in Scotland. We also consulted those two bodies in relation to the provisions in the amendment rules. At the end of the day, we took on board any comments that those organisations made, and those views are reflected in the amendment regulations.
Well, it's just a suggestion, but it might be helpful in future is that if you do a consultation and there are no major issues, and then you've adopted or taken on board the issues that were raised, to actually say that in the papers, because it doesn't say anything. Just as a consultation was undertaken, and then is silent. So I just think it might be helpful to committee members, at least if not to others, to point out that has taken place.
Okay.
Mary Scanlon.
Convener, I would also find it helpful if there was a little bit less gobbledygook. And I'm afraid I read this 2-3 times last night, and I wasn't on the committee when the bill was passed, so I don't have that sort of framework of reference. But I haven't actually found it totally helpful this morning. I understand in my own mind what's happening on children being placed in secure accommodation. So I wonder, Convener, can I just ask the Minister in her own words, for the sake of those of us that weren't on the committee during the passing of the bill, can she just put it in her own words and tell us what this means?
Is it, sorry, are you asking specifically about the children's hearing one?
Just the children's hearing one, yes, please. Thank you.
Minister.
The children's hearing, not the secure accommodation?
Yes.
Secure accommodation, sorry. Yeah.
So right. In the secure accommodation regulations.
Which one is it, yes. Mary, you're asking about?
The children's
hearing or the secure accommodation?
It actually mentions children's hearing as well. I'm looking at this explanatory note on page 13. Children's hearing on which the grounds of hearing has required a principal reporter to arrange in accordance da-di-da of 95.2 of the 2011 Act must take place within 72 hours of the child being placed in secure accommodation.
Secure accommodation.
So it relates to children's hearings, but it's the one about secure accommodation.
It's the secure accommodation one, Minister.
Thank you.
Mary's asking for some...
That's what I mean about the gobbledygook.
Plain English explanation.
Plain English would be very helpful. One. Thank you.
So the regulation on the to amend the secure accommodation amendment regulations, Regulation 8, is a consequence of Section 86 of the 2014 Act, and it's about interim compulsory supervision orders being able to be made when a child is unable to attend a hearing but is not excused from attending the hearing. So this is about when it is necessary to make a compulsory order in an urgent situation. But perhaps Liz could...
Sure. Telling me it's a consequence of an act isn't very helpful when I wasn't here and, you know, I don't know about the act. I just want this in plain English to know what I'm agreeing to.
Okay, if I can help. The Section 86 of the Children and Young People Act, it introduced some amendments to deal with the situation where a child can't attend a grounds hearing, but the children's hearing considers that because of the nature of the child's circumstances on that day, they require to because it's a matter of urgency, they require to make an interim compulsory supervision order. Before this change was made, there was no power for a children's hearing to make an interim compulsory supervision order to deal with those urgent circumstances where a child is not able to attend the hearing. So the change that the Secure Accommodation Scotland amendment regulations are making is just purely in consequence of that new power being given to a children's hearing to make an interim compulsory supervision order. So where a children's hearing makes an interim compulsory supervision order under this new power in this urgent circumstance, what this amendment in the amendment regulation says is that the children's hearing where the interim compulsory supervision order is made and a children's hearing is required to take place following that, the
that children's hearing has to take place within 72 hours of the interim order having been made. So it's purely to put the amendment that you're considering today is purely to put that 72-hour timescale on the children's hearing following the making of the interim order.
I think that was very helpful, actually. I mean, I think that has actually clarified.
It was more helpful than what we had, certainly. But a little bit less gobbledygook in future, convener, would be even more helpful.
I'm sure the Plain English Society are right behind you there, Mary.
I hope so, yeah.
Thank you.
I'll try as hard as possible to put it in plain English. These are regulations consequential to an act. Therefore, there is technicalities that we have to ensure are there.
There are explanatory notes which would be helpful if they were in plain English, but I do understand there are technicalities.
Okay, that was very helpful. Thank you, for Minister and officials, for those explanations and those answers. If there are no other questions at this stage, okay, can I move on to agenda item 5? As indicated, we now move to the formal debate on the instruments. Can I invite the Minister to speak and move motion S4M 12017?
Thank you, Convener. I think all the explanation has been given. So I would move that the committee approve the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011 Rules of Procedure and Children's Hearings Amendment Rules 2015.
Thank you, Minister. Any contributions from members? Stage. Okay. I presume you don't need to respond.
Thank you.
Can I put the question, therefore, that motion S4M 12017 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Can I thank you very much? Can I now invite the Minister to speak to and move motion S4M 12018?
Again, I think all the explanation has been given, so I would move that the committee approve the Secure Accommodation Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015.
Thank you. Any contributions from members? Nope. Can I put the question, therefore, that motion S4M 12018 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. Thank you, Minister, and thank you, officials, as well, for coming along this morning. Our next committee meeting will be on the 27th of January. Next week, we have an informal visit to meet with BSL users in connection with our scrutiny of the BSL Scotland Bill. And therefore, after that, I close the meeting.